pleased to be joined by it's a delightful segment. Same time, same day, every single week now. Kind enough to agree to do this throughout the football season. Wednesday is when the latest episode of his popular podcast on the Ringer and Spotify drops. The host of 10 Questions with Kyle Brandt and co-host of Good Morning Football every 7 a.m. Eastern on NFL Network every single day. Back here on the Rich Eisen Show. How are you, Kyle?
Rich, I come for the sports talk, but I stay for the commercial chatter between you guys. It's the only show I do where I Google things as I'm listening so I can keep up with the references. I was just Googling flauta, which is a Mexican dish consisting of a tortilla rolled around a filling of meat and then fried. It sounds delicious, and I love the commercial chatter always.
Well, the reason why we have conjured that up, Kyle, is because, again, you know, every single day we're on NBC Sports on Peacock right in the middle. And there's a five-show day that starts and ends with Pro Football Talk. So we decided to call it, I call it a Florio burrito, and then somebody kicked it up a notch, to use the phrase.
The Florio Flauta, hashtag Florio Flauta, hashtag Choco Taco. You guys could sit around and talk about gas prices and it's the standings in the NFL. You always come up with a fun topic.
Well, it's funny you mention that because Flautas are big at 7-Eleven where you can also get a Choco Taco.
Interesting.
Oh, the best, most authentic Mexican cuisine there is.
Look at you connecting dots. Look at you connecting dots.
Rich, I've been with you a long time.
Well, we also we also just talked about how, Kyle, I showed my kids, 12, 9, and 7, Karate Kid for the first time over the weekend. And one thing I just forgot about this film is I don't recall ever seeing a movie build up to a big moment, pay it off, and go to credits literally within 20 seconds. Like it's one of those TV shows where they're counting you down to commercial break. You got to go. And I forgot about that. It builds, it crescendos, and then they roll credits. It's over.
It seems to be, Rich, in the space of about 6 seconds, Miyagi is working on Daniel's leg, and then you blink your eyes, the crane kick has landed, Johnny Lawrence has completed a wild character arc and is weeping, saying, "You're all right, LaRusso," handing them the trophy, Liz Shue runs on, is in love with him, and roll credits. It's nuts, and it's so nuts, I don't think it's a coincidence, Rich, that in Karate Kid 2, it picks up immediately in the parking lot of the All-Valley Karate Tournament, as if to say, this is what we wanted to do.
Did they run out of budget? Is that what it was? Did they run out of budget? They spent.
It went off to Joe Esposito. He wasn't cheap back then, and he was the best around. So maybe they just ran out of film, and they're like, we wanted a little epilogue with Miyagi back taking care of his swimming pool and painting fences. We got to go. We're out of money. We'll see you in the sequel.
I almost did say to my kids, and I just held off on it because it was just too much. When it was the you're the best montage, that to explain to my children what an exposition montage is. And how this is going to be in every single movie that they watch for the rest of their life, just to keep things moving along.
They don't get that. I don't. We were all reared on montages. I'm not sure that they get the same thing. I am fascinated by the dynamic, Rich. My son and my daughter are not old enough to watch The Karate Kid yet. Were there strange teaching moments? Like it's always been a little weird that Mr. Miyagi like badly beats up some high school kids, which is a little bit strange. I bet the strange teachable. He could have just defused the fight. He beats up kids who are maybe 16 years old, which is he probably would be arrested for.
Well, I mean, if I did begin to go down that road, I would also have to explain why an older gentleman was standing on the other side of a chain link fence ready to pounce on children. It adds a stalking element I don't know if I want to get into. You know, it's kind of weird. The whole thing, it kind of falls apart if you start picking at it. Kyle, you know,
Daniel's son,
is what I want to see walking down your street at Halloween, socially distanced. I would love to see the Eisen children dressed in skeleton costumes and their father dressed as a shower.
That's not a bad one.
Yeah, I was going to ask if they were freaked out by the skeleton costume.
No, it's all good. It's all good. But the teachable moments were don't give up. Don't throw. You can't throw your bicycle in the trash.
Nope.
You know, you can't give up. That sometimes when you're being tasked to do something, it's for a greater cause and also a greater effort. You know, the whole paint the fence and wax on, wax off, all of that. I tried. I don't know if it stuck. I don't know, but we'll find out. I just figured I'd bring up the fact that, again, I don't recall another movie that goes and builds to the moment and rolls credits quite like that.
It is incredible. It ends very fast. It's like a November rain or something. All of a sudden, it changes dramatically, and it's over.
See, I knew you'd come up with another one. I knew you'd at least have another one. Kyle Brandt here, on the Rich Eisen Show. Let's talk a little football before we return to your pod and the pop culture poll question of the day. So the storyline now in the NFL is NFC wide open, right? AFC, AFC, it's now Pittsburgh or Tennessee that could give the Chiefs their biggest run for the money. Am I wrong, or what do you think? Who am I missing?
Well, I think it's interesting, and I think it's appropriate that you left one team out of that. If you look in the AFC standings, there's about four, maybe even five or six potential juggernauts. The one you did not say was Baltimore, and I wouldn't have said it either, because they have a Kansas City problem.
Yes, that's right.
It's not a coincidence.
Right.
They have a Mahomes issue and a and Kansas City issue. But I am looking at these teams, Rich. I like the way Indianapolis plays late in the season. I'm really, really, really intrigued by the Miami Dolphins right now.
No doubt.
And I mean, I think it is the biggest thing that has happened over the last 48 hours with Tua and what we're going to see from him and what we're going to see from Brian Flores, because they blew on the dice and rolled that thing, and I respect the hell out of it.
So do I. I mean, I've been all in on that subject since it broke before we went on the air on this show yesterday. It broke probably right after you signed off on Good Morning Football. Mm-hmm. Chris Carter was on earlier today, talked about how special he is. I don't know why anybody would take the other side of it right now. Unless you're in the Fitzpatrick family, I totally understand what he has done and what he could have done with this team. But this sounds like a great move. At some point, you have to do it. And clearly they've seen something special that we haven't seen in practice, Kyle.
They've seen that, and they could make the move now, or you can wait until Fitzpatrick loses two of the next three and then make the move. And he will do that. Here's the thing. Everybody loves Fitzpatrick. He's Harvard Santa Claus. We all love him. We love Fitzmagic. We love all the kids and all the antics on the field. We have a lot of tape on him. It's 15 years now, and we know that Fitzmagic ride goes up and it goes down. I mean, I got receipts. You could look at the Bills, the Jets, even as recently as 2018 with the Bucks. He wins and everybody says, Fitzmagic, Fitzmagic. And then they win one of the next five and it's Fitztragic. I think the Dolphins are saying, Ryan, thank you. Thank you for your service. You've won some games and now let's go. And listen, people are also forgetting the magic of Tua Tagovailoa. I firmly believe if he was not hurt at Alabama, he would be on the Cincinnati Bengals right now. I think they would have taken him number one. He was that good, that magic. I think they've seen something in practice that they're like, you think we're putting him in too early? We shouldn't have even waited this long. Get him in there. It's a great move. It may blow up. Maybe he doesn't have it, but I would be shocked. I think he's very special.
Either way, the ride's amazing. I mean, I'll just quickly go down it one more time. You know, first up against Goff, first pick overall, second game against Kyler Murray. Then he's got a game against Drew Locke, Sam Darnold. Next one after that is against Joe Burrow. I mean, Cincinnati-Miami is not really going to be, you know, you would think worthy of a large audience. Now it certainly will be. And then the big crescendo the last 4 weeks, Mahomes, Cameron Newton. We know that game against Derek Carr in Vegas is going to be important potentially for both teams. And then at Buffalo and Josh Allen, the first of two times we're going to see them every single year. You know, it's going to be glorious. It's going to be must see every last second of it, I think. Really.
And I think Flores will be too. The Dolphins for 25 years have been prisoners of short-term thinking and conservative approaches. He said, no way. I don't care. We're doing it now. That's how you do it. Empire moves, as Walter White would say.
Empire moves. That's, I guess you're G damn right, you know, I mean, to use another phrase by him right there, you know,
right.
The Dolphins are now the one who knocks. Kyle Brandt here on the Rich Eisen Show. So what do the Cowboys do, man? I mean, Chris Brockman later on is going to be in our news segment. We're going to play the soundbite from Mike McCarthy talking about what Jane Slater, our colleague, reported from two unnamed Cowboys yesterday. It sounds completely ineffectual. All of it does. I don't know what can be done. I place this in your lap, sir.
It's not an easy thing to have on your lap. I don't have the schadenfreude about the Dallas Cowboys that many people do. Like, I don't feel that way. I don't relish that. And there's no easy answer. Mike McCarthy looks miserable. And I mean his body language, his demeanor, his coaching, and the sideline and the press conference. I don't know. Maybe he went to the Jones boys and sold them that he had a Super Bowl ring because he got Aaron Rodgers and then took a year off and read Analytics for Dummies, and they said, we got to hire you. It doesn't look like a good fit, and this is before Dak Prescott got hurt. The only thing I could say to try to make this positive and proactive, I remember a 2-5 Dallas Cowboys team who said, this is not good enough, and we're going to go out and we're going to do something crazy. And they got Amari Cooper, and our Amari Cooper exploded. If you want to take another look around in the next 2 weeks, and the ignorant thing to do would be like, nah, let's just stay the course. Let's fix this. This team's terrible. They're not fixing anything. They will lose the NFC East with this team. If you want to go shopping and you want to do something wild and look at Earl Thomas again, if you want to look at some players around the league who might be ripe for a trade, like Justin Simmons in Denver, who does not have a long-term deal, Jerry, write a check, because I don't think this is a thing about, well, let's have a players-only meeting and let's just work this. It's not there. If it was going to be there, it would have been already. And the worst part is, Rich, the defense thing that we've been kicking around for last month, defense came out against the Cardinals and held them to 3 punts in the first 3 possessions. Punt, punt, punt. Ezekiel Elliott, the $90 million running back, is fumbling all over the field. He's the reason they lost that game. So it's now spreading. And unless they do something dramatic, like a bold Amari Cooper-type new player on defense, I don't see it stopping.
And then we're talking about week 7, and there are marquee matchups all over the place. The one that I'm looking forward to the most, and this is fact, and I just love the way they both play, and I love the way that both teams play, is Seattle and Arizona. I cannot wait for that one, and that's got the early, it's the late window, but it's got the 4:05 Eastern start. Then they're just going to go right away. I can't wait for that. That's going to be amazing.
Yeah, because it's like it's Russ versus like kind of mini Russ in what Kyler did, and everyone was so excited. He's gotten such little national exposure. If he slays the Dragon, which is the Seahawks, maybe the best team in the league, it's outstanding. I would look in the same afternoon window, Niners at Patriots. Mm-hmm. In which we are on the precipice of seeing a 2-4 Bill Belichick Patriots team, which is like end of time stuff. It's very strange. And then they may be a player at the deadline because their goose might be cooked. It's big time stakes here, big time. And because now, Rich, we're getting to like we know who the good teams and bad teams are. It's not early, it's not late, but now you're getting the wild takes. I saw something. I follow Green Bay Packers beat writers on Twitter, and I love the content they churn out. They got people calling radio shows and writing in saying, we got to take a look at this Jordan Love now. It's time.
Oh,
get
the crazy
pads on him. Let's go. I mean,
come on.
You
got to
be kidding me.
Come on.
This is week 7 in the NFL. Trade Sam Darnold, tank for Trevor, and get Jordan Love up.
Well, I agree with the first part. I absolutely think the Jets should tank for Trevor. There's no question about that. I mean, I don't think that's tinfoil hat on my front. I think that this kid is as dynamic as they come. The Jets have broken Sam Darnold. This coach is finished. I don't know why he's still around, unless they just say, we're punishing you by keeping you around. I have no idea what the hell the direction is. And I started this hour basically saying Jets need to fire Gase if the awfulness and the absolute dreadfulness it makes him look that much more clueless, where Trevor Lawrence might think, you know, a little Thornton Mellon, do the triple Lindy and go and go back to school, you know, is the way to go. If that's the case, then Gase should be out 5 minutes ago.
Trevor, we need you.
Yeah.
They do need him. They do need him, Rich. But here's the thing. You fire Gase, then who's to say you don't go and win a 3 out of the next 6 games or something and end up and totally blow it and have the number 3 pick in the draft? Maybe you keep Gase to go full scorched earth to get it. Maybe Gase is the best thing they have going for him right now to get Trevor Lawrence.
I know.
And then you can.
That's what I was thinking about. But at any rate, there's still a whole bunch of time left between now and then. Let's talk about your pod, because my next my celebrity guest in hour 3 is your guest for your pod this week.
Oh, nice.
A little bit of overlap. This is kind of like a, if you will, a multi-platform Venn diagram, which is a great, I think, fantasy name, Chris. Patton Oswalt is your, what do you got for me here for Patton? What'd you talk about?
Incredible guest, or I call it contestant, on the show. 25 years of experience in Hollywood. He, in doing the research, he was in a very memorable episode of Seinfeld. It was one of his first breaks ever, where he played a video clerk, and George Costanza is trying to rent Breakfast at Tiffany's so he doesn't have to read the book for the book club that he's in, and the guy won't do it. And he has great stories, Patton does, about Jason Alexander just messing with him and trying to screw him up before he started his line and try to loosen him up. Amazing guy who is game for anything And I didn't know a ton about him as recently as a month ago. I've learned everything. I mean, he's the voice of Ratatouille, which, Rich, as you know, as a Pixar
huge.
Household, makes him royalty.
It does. So you play the old 10 questions with him, and and he's got a virtual comedy performance that's coming up, so I'll be talking about that with him in the next hour. Ask the poll question of Kyle Brandt as we go out the door. Go for it.
Kyle, as I'm sure you're aware, it's the 37th anniversary of the release of All the Right Moves today.
Oh, yeah.
So we are going best 80s cruise movie. All the Right Moves not on the list, but these four are Risky Business, Top Gun, Cocktail, Rain Man.
Oh, man, that's tough. All right, which delicious flavor do I want to have from
that's what
those? It's tough to take down Top Gun. I mean, it's even if you would gave me 4 minutes of footage of the volleyball scene with Kenny Loggins, or even the date at Kelly McGillis's, or Maverick inexplicably sidearm throwing the dog tags off the deck carrier, I think I have to go with Top Gun. Although I have to say something very strange, a tangent off that.
Yes.
Rich, you and I talked a couple weeks ago. I had Tim Robbins on 10 Questions.
Yes.
And, of course, Tim Robbins played Merlin, who gets a real raw deal. He's Cougar's co-pilot, and then he's Maverick. They're both head cases. And I just wanted to reminisce about Top Gun, and he kind of played along, and then he said, you know, actually, I don't really like that movie. You don't like Top Gun? No, I think it's jingoistic, and it was paid for with tax dollars, so I'm not really a fan.
Wow.
That's a take. That is a take, and he stood by it, and he did not want anything to do with Top Gun 2, so you will not see Merlin in the sequel.
You will not see that.
No.
Okay, so Kyle has flown into the danger zone. Where does that rank right now, Kyle? Chris?
Oh, Top Gun is just running
away with
65%
it?
65% Top Gun.
So let's pound the table for like Risky Business.
I mean,
is it too old? That's almost the 70s movie. That's how old that movie is.
Yeah, it's very – Tom Cruise looks like he's in about eighth grade in it, which plays right in it. Shot in the north suburbs of Chicago, about 5 minutes from the Bears headquarters. The In the Air Tonight, Phil Collins, it really put that on the map. So it's a great movie. But listen, you could open it up to all Tom Cruise movies, and it's tough to take down Top Gun and Pete Mitchell. I mean, you could throw Jerry Maguire at him, anything you want. Top Gun may still take that thing, requesting a flyby, negative Ghost Rider, the pattern is full.
By the way, Depeche Mode, also a great band from Risky Business as well. That's if you want to go,
old-time rock and roll.
If you want to go, that's Bob Seger, too. I mean,
scene with him dancing?
I don't know if Seger and Depeche Mode and the sultry Becky De Mornay does it for the young demo, but it definitely does it for me. I don't care.
I know that. Becky De Mornay. And by the way, also, let's go down this wormhole. Let's do it.
Okay.
The guy who sold all of Joel his stolen goods back off the back of the truck, Joey Pants, Joe Pantoliano.
Oh.
Who is, Midnight
great,
Run fame, one of the all-time great. Exactly. Yeah. Also,
he in the
fugitive.
Role of Guido the Killer Pimp.
Yes.
Joey Pants. And Curtis Armstrong, known as Booger in the Revenge of the Nerds world, has that great line, I've got a trig midterm tomorrow. I'm getting chased by Guido the Killer Pimp. Great movie.
It is. Let's pound the table. And so, last one for you, too, is that we had Rob Lowe on our show a couple years ago, a couple times ago when he was on. He said when we asked him about, knowing Cruise and growing up with Tom Cruise, not just, as a movie actor, but also here in Southern California, literally, he said that he learned from Tom Cruise that to sound really cool, Cruise only refers to his movies with one word.
Oh, my gosh.
In the title. So I guess it would be, he said that, as a matter of fact, he referred to All the Right Moves as Moves. When I was on the set of Moves. So, I guess, what would it be?
Wow.
Would it be Risky or Business? Would it be, right?
I think.
Yeah. I think it'd be Business.
Right?
I just wonder, how far does it go? Z say, I remember I was working with Bobby Duvall on the set of Thunder, and it was just a hell of a shoot.
Right.
I mean,
Gun? I think, didn't he say it was Days? He said it was Days.
Yeah. Days.
That's what he used. It was Days.
Because he did Tropic Thunder, too, so
you can't do right.
Yeah, so can't have double thunder.
That might be Tropic, though. Yeah. So you could really go down a wormhole, no doubt about it. I think it was Gun.
Gun.
When he was on that.
Yep.
Mission.
Yep.
Okay, is it that one as well? We just need to leave it there with Cocktail.
Yes.
Okay, we need to just, that's what we're getting to use a phrase that all the CNN anchors use. We've got to leave it there.
Gotta leave it there.
You gotta leave it there.
But, man, this makes me want to go see Vanilla and maybe his great scene with Jack Nicholson and Men.
Yes.
And he keeps going.
It Thunder, does.
Collateral, I guess that's one word. Yeah. These are great. Yeah. I love this about
Oh, it's a great game, Kyle. It's a great game.
It's fun.
It's fun to play.
Fun.
10 questions with Kyle Brandt, the latest pod with Patton Oswalt is where all pods can be gotten on Spotify and The Ringer. Thanks for the call. You take care of yourself, brother. We'll chat next week.
Always. Thanks, Rich.
Always a pleasure with Kyle Brandt, the delightful Kyle Brandt. Hey, you watched all the way to the end. Thanks for that. Watch more right here.